Well, hello, everybody. Welcome to this very special panel. If you heard me speak yesterday or earlier today, I talked about this panel as one of the highlights of homecoming reunions every year. It's not just because I get to speak, because I get to speak at everything, so it's not that. It's because I get to listen and learn, and I really absolutely love doing this sort of thing. So there are seats here, still up in front. It's getting crowded, but there's still seats, so make yourself at home. There will be an interaction, not only among the panelists, but from the audience. So I think we have, Kev, how many, an hour and 15 minutes, is that pretty much? So I will make sure we leave sufficient time so that you could ask really good penetrating questions, okay? So think about that, penetrating. And we will have a mic that's gonna be available for that. The one thing we're doing different, and you guys are going to just love this, is we're going to put embarrassing pictures of you behind you, especially you, Ana. And we're going to do, in all kinds of compromising, Jim, compromising situations and positions, and so we're going to do that, right? Kevin, I'm looking forward to seeing, unfortunately, there's none of me up there, so I'm really relieved about that. The way I start every year is just to have the panelists introduce themselves, and not just say who they are and what year they graduated, but tell us a little bit, take 5 minutes or so each to tell a story of how you got from Northwestern, what did you study, and what was your career path that got you to where you are today. And we'll go down the panel right here from, is this stage right or stage left? Whatever it is. Thank you, stage right, thank you. So given you know that, we'll start with you. And we'll put up the picture, and you'll introduce yourself. Here it is, you can, no, you're not allowed to turn around. No, you are, yeah.
Some 80s hair, that's fantastic.
Yeah, so it's a little compilation of
it's beautiful.
Different kinds of things, yeah.
Except you didn't circle me, you circled my hot friend.
Yeah.
That's me, the sort of androgynous one.
So where's your friend?
She's the hot one in the upper left. Oh, she's a television writer. She was my maid of honor.
We tried to.
Her name is Jill Kargerman, but she's she would have graduated a year behind me.
I would have asked her.
So next year.
Ask her to be here next year.
We already have the artwork.
And we'll show a picture of you. We'll show a picture of you for Jill. There's Jill, and it's Ana. So yeah.
Yeah, I'm actually wearing these boots in her honor because Ana Gasteyer. I graduated in 1989, and not just for saying it, everything about my career started right here in this room in McCormick Auditorium where we did the Meow Show, as featured behind me. Absolutely no question. I came to Northwestern as a voice major in the School of Music to do a 5-year program so my parents would get off my back about having a liberal arts education.
Yeah.
And I assessed quickly that I did not want to be an opera singer because I got in trouble for laughing too much and stuff in class. And
if I can interject, I actually listened to your album. She released an album. And it is absolutely spectacular. And there's a very, Mima, I forgot to tell you, but it's my wife, Mimi, a wonderful, really sketchy kind of video. But anyway, speaking of your years here, Ana,
yes.
Well, you kissing the people and all
I
that
kiss
stuff.
People. Okay. People, yeah, that's not that sketchy anymore.
Well, I'm a professor. For
yeah,
me,
that's
kind of risque. But anyway, I'm glad because I wanted to mention everyone should. Do you still buy albums? You just illegally download them. What do you do?
You can go to iTunes and you can buy it.
Okay.
And you can also go to YouTube and thumbs up the sketchy video. That's actually really important.
Yeah, I did that twice, actually.
Thank you. Good.
Yeah. So I just want to do a little plug that in addition to it being an incredible actress, you know, she's a great singer. Absolutely good. This is your first album, right?
It's my first album, yeah.
It's about time.
Thanks.
Sorry, keep going.
No problem. So I started as a voice major, and then I found the Meow Show, and I slid very quickly over to the School of Speech. But Meow is, in a nutshell, just where it all began. I learned how to write for myself. Writing and performing became the cornerstone of my career. Obviously, I went on to Saturday Night Live, and then, oddly enough, the School of Music discipline and training that got me that far. Even though I was a bit of a flunky and switching over to the School of Speech also led to my, you know, great sense of discipline and passion for Broadway. So after I left Saturday Night Live, I ended up working on Broadway at a number of shows. I did Wicked here in Chicago for a very long time, and sort of ended up using both fields of study in a very clean and applicable way. And I moved, after I graduated, I moved out to LA because a bossy Northwestern friend told me to move there, and super bossy. And he and I lived in a one-bedroom apartment with four Northwestern grads, and I got my day job because of a Northwestern person. And literally, there was, I won't take up too much time, but there was, this was, I moved to a one-bedroom apartment. There was a four Northwestern grads, all different classes, all actors. One technically lived in the closet whilst in the closet. I graduated in the late 80s, remember, so it took a while. And then one was a substitute teacher who lived in the dining room, and she got up at 4 o'clock in the morning. Her day job was to be a substitute teacher. One person slept in the regular bedroom. She was a waitress. She got home at 4 in the morning. And then they said, oh, you should sleep. We have a futon. And I got there. It was in the living room. It was a Pier 1 Papasan chair insert. So it was like one of those kind of foam cushions. So that's where I began in LA, but I got all my day job, I got everything. I got my first voiceover agent from a Northwestern friend, and I still do voiceover work to this day. So I'm incredibly indebted to my education here and also very significantly to the community and to the alumni relationships that I have still.
Beautiful. Thank you. Jim? Yeah, let's clap. We can clap. So we're going to put up a picture of Jim's best friend as well. Jim, does that happen to be you, or that the circled one?
Yes, it actually is.
Oh, darn. I thought there was a pattern here.
You see, Morty seated me here to be the person of contrast to the lady to my right. You know, you got to have somebody like that. So, no, I don't have any albums to offer, I'm sorry, and I've not appeared on Broadway except in the audience. So, however, I did come to Northwestern, and I did not only learn a trade, but because of what I found out in the business school about the variety of opportunities and the roles to play in business, I had a very successful career in business. In fact, it still continues. The main thing that I learned, in addition to all these great opportunities, was community service. I had it drummed into me by people at Northwestern that if you're successful in the professional world, you not only can make a big difference in the not-for-profit world, but you should do that. So as I was telling some of the folks earlier, I've spent a lot of time right now down in Haiti working with some orphanages and working to start an entrepreneurship center and to teach young Haitians how to start new businesses. All that stemmed from my time at Northwestern and the push in the direction that I was given here.
Beautiful, thank you.
We can clap.
Terry?
So I actually graduated with a degree in French. I started out in the theater department in the School of Speech.
You didn't even turn around. You're not curious to see what we did to you?
Oh, God. Oh, yeah.
Oh, God. Women at NU, hey?
That's the one. That's the down. It's
prescient,
horrible.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's really bad. I don't even know if that's me. None of those are me. Anyway, I was from New Canaan, Connecticut. I started out in the School of Speech in the theater department, and after about a year and a half, it really became very clear that I wasn't that good at it. I was making great grades in the arts and sciences in the French department. And I thought, well, so I told my parents I want to transfer over to arts and sciences. Of course, my parents were thrilled. They said, theater, really? My mother said, you'll starve. And, you know, so I transferred into French, and I'd been there a while, and I started taking this amazing course from Professor William Payton, who just really pushed me very hard. It was a course on the 12th century languages from southern France. So we were doing French, and how it sort of migrated to become modern French and other modern languages. And I announced to my parents that I knew what I wanted to do with my life. I wanted to become a medieval scholar. And of course, my mother said, "You'll starve. What are you talking about?" So I eventually, I actually couldn't get the courage up to take the GREs. But Professor Payton pushed me after graduating. He liked a paper that I had written at the capstone paper, mm-hmm. and he liked it. Said it should be published. So he kept. He would pitch it to a publication. They would say, "No, we can't publish it. But if you change it up this way, you know." So he would say, "Here, go do some more research. Write this piece. Do that." And it took 2 years, and he stayed on it. And my life, you know, I was 22, 23. My life was really off track. And I remember having a conversation with him where basically he said, "Yes, I'm sorry about your divorce. Now about that paper, I really think that we can." You know, we can get, and it did get published, and fast forward, I actually ended up going to law school instead of graduate school, and I landed an interview at the Seventh Circuit Court of Appeals in Chicago, which I desperately wanted this job. Hmm. I got the job offer, and I learned later that the reason I had gotten the interview was because the law clerk who was screening all the applications that year told me, she said, "I never saw an application with a publication on troubadour poetry." "And I just wanted to meet you in person." But Judge Fairchild gave me the job, which was really, really great. So yes, it was that's Northwestern really gave me that good start.
That's wonderful. Yeah. So Kip, I think we're gonna see you in shorts. I that was my guess. That is you, right? That's you. Yeah.
That is me.
Yes.
There's some pictures of people dunking over me, so thank you for picking this one. I love coming to. Is this working?
Yeah.
I love coming to Northwestern. I feel honored to be with this panel here. My route to Northwestern was much simpler. I was tall and skinny and grew up in Kentucky. And made more three-pointers than I missed. So my life up until I was about 18 was about basketball. And I was luckily a good student, but life to me was trying to chase my wife, who's here, Sarah, who grew up with me in Kentucky, and shooting baskets. And I was fortunate enough to be exposed to Northwestern, and it really changed my life in much the same way as other people have talked about. I went into a career in business, but just being exposed to not only Northwestern, but my wife and I still refer to Chicago as the big city. Being around Northwestern and the people we met, being challenged academically, realizing what all these smart people used to say, intellectually curious, I learned that here. And it was just a terrific experience. Northwestern alums helped me make a transition into the business world. And then I think because of Northwestern, after going into the investment world, having some success, I felt like there was more to life than just being successful in business. I actually was crazy enough to consider running for office in Illinois. I think a lot of that was attributed to a lot of the people that I met at Northwestern, after decided not to put my family through that, have tried to start what I think is going to be the next generation of investment firms focused on making an impact socially, not just returning money to investors. And a lot of that started with my experience here in Evanston.
That's great. Thanks, Kip. Madhuri? Wow, look at this whole, it's a lot of words here.
Yes.
Oh, there you are.
And I have to say, I'm very happy that this is what's up there instead of my senior year is actually when Facebook started. So when you started putting pictures up, I started to get a little afraid about what would be up there. So the start of that generation was my time here at Northwestern. So when I got to Northwestern about 15 years ago, I'm Madhuri Kommareddi, class of 2004. I was, you know, really focused on making a difference in the world, and in particular, I was really focused on making a difference through politics. And for not only, I think, those of us who went to Northwestern, but of course those of you here who now live in Chicago, you know there's an election every other day in Chicago. And so I kind of thrust myself into electoral politics. I sadly probably didn't apply myself as much academically as I should have, and just really started to, whatever campaign would take me, I would volunteer on. I started doing paid work. And then by my senior year of college, I had enough time. I was able to work with the academic counseling staff at Northwestern, who were able to tell me I could take 2 quarters off and still graduate on time. So I decided to take time off to work for this state senator in Chicago, who at the time I thought his name was pronounced Barack Obama. And thankfully, before I interviewed with him, somebody corrected me. And was able to, so I started working for him. So I was 20 years old. I worked as his long shot primary campaign scheduler and operations director. And then, of course, as we know, he won. After he won that primary, I dutifully, though, returned to Northwestern to finish my last quarter, finish my undergraduate thesis, and then from there kind of went with the now president to a Senate office in Washington, worked on his presidential campaign, worked in the White House, was very lucky to do that as well. At some point, I finished a law degree, and I started to rethink, is politics what I want to do, or is it something else? Is it maybe nonprofit work? And so for the past few years, that's what I've been doing, and now I'm at the Clinton Foundation, where I'm working for Secretary Hillary Clinton, doing some economic empowerment work for young people in this country. And so for me, my career really started as soon as I set foot on the Northwestern campus here. And I'm incredibly grateful for the flexibility that Northwestern offered me to kind of take time off and to work and to really expose myself while I was able to do my undergrad degree as well.
Beautiful. So, you putting up a picture of me here or something? No, good, thank you. Let me go down the line and ask each of you a question based on sort of just listening to what you just said. So Ana, I'm gonna start with you. And this is a serious question. So what's more fun, being a tenured member of the Northwestern faculty in zoology or trying to raise Lindsay Lohan? Are you gonna explain what that's about? Or you want me to? You do it.
I think you're referring to the movie Mean Girls.
You think so?
Yeah.
You think?
Which apparently has a big,
I know that was a while ago and was just a small part of your career.
Yes, I think I was but a party pooper when the Daily Northwestern asked me about it.
It was kind of cool, though, her character in the movie,
yes.
The iconic movie Mean Girls, was, what's the opening line? My parents just got... job. I think we left Africa. My parents just got jobs. They're zoologists. They just got tenure at Northwestern, so I'm moving to Evanston. That was Lindsay Lohan's opening line, right?
I'm just surprised they got tenure while they were in Africa.
We do that
clearly
quite often.
By a comedian. Yeah.
We do that quite often. Yeah, we just randomly take people and we give them tenure.
Nice.
So, but it was kind of cool that you played a role where you were a tenured faculty member at your alma mater.
Yes, it did. It was nice. I mean, it, you know, again, movies are so dissociative. Like, we shot it in Toronto, and, you know.
You didn't shoot it in Evanston?
No, I wish we did.
Aww.
But no, we didn't.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it made Lindsay Lohan a big star, which was, you know, great at that time.
So, how'd that turn out? Pretty well,
you know,
huh?
Yeah. So that's, what was the question?
It was sort of a funny question. It was trying to impress you that I watched the movie Mean Girls.
I know,
Girls.
You know the movie way better than I do.
Yeah, because you seemed a little confused about that.
I am confused, yeah. I'm impressed by it. But I feel, I know people tweet lines about it to me sometimes. And my daughter, my seventh grader, is reaching the age where she says, can we rent it? And I say no. That's about it.
You know, I'm going to buy it for you because
okay,
it's not
so
that
much
money about renting. So here's a more serious question as an actress. Do you recall real experiences that happened to you? Do you, like a professor you might have had, or, I mean, obviously you played an older character, so you didn't have kids then, but, you know, can you reflect a little bit about that?
I definitely think, just to bring it to the theme of what Northwestern does for you, that it, you know, I very much lobbied to go to, I spoke about this with some of the senior theater majors this morning, I really knew, I'm one of the weird people who knew what I was good at and what I wanted to do basically by high school. And you know, whether or not that was going to pan out, I didn't know. And so I really lobbied. I really wanted to go to Juilliard or North Carolina School for the Arts or these specialized programs. And my parents really strongly discouraged it, not only because of the backup kind of plan mentality, but backup career mentality, but because they were right. I grew up in a very rarefied little world in Washington, D.C. I actually went to the high school where the Obama girls go. It was very small, specialized. We didn't even have, when I came here, I didn't know that sororities existed. I thought that they were from the 50s. And like, so to me, to come to the Midwest, to come to a really national school that had all kinds of influences from all over the country, all kinds of people from all walks of life, absolutely impacted what I ended up doing in a really unconscious way in terms of who I recreated as an actor, what things I wrote about. It just opened up my worldview in a really interesting and global way. And I took all kinds of classes, not just theater classes. I took social history of art, and I took creative writing, and I took all kinds of things that really impacted who I am now as well, I would say.
That's great, thank you. So Jim, you've had a tremendous corporate world, being CEO of major companies, and you've been on a whole bunch of boards. I think you still chair a couple of the boards of major companies. And as somebody teaches economics, and a lot of my students are very focused on going to McKinsey or going to Goldman, you know, because I do econ math, and that's sort of the path. I always try to remind them that, you know, it's not a choice between serving society and contributing to the business world and becoming materially well off. And I'm really struck that one of the things you immediately talked about was Haiti. And you really didn't talk, you kind of glossed over an incredibly successful business career. So, you know, my question is really, was that always in you, that was your business career part of a way to get successful enough to give back outside of business? And also, how do you instill that in the next generation?
A lot of it, Marty, I think came from a professor. Most of us have professors that we look back to, and I had a professor of auditing whose name was Ambrose Ryder. Now, we met in the basement of the old little red brick building. It was the business school, and you had pipes going over, and we met at the ungodly hour of 3 to 5 on a Friday afternoon. And Ambrose had come in, and he looked like one of these street people that, you know, and he brought his dog. The dog was always a part of the, but, and he wandered around the classroom, and you always had to be on guard because he might sneak up on you. And he was one of the original in-your-face kind of guys. And he'd get on my face, and he'd, you know, first thing that I can vividly remember, he says, Gagley, this auditing is the glue that holds together the financial system of all of America's finances. Wow. Okay, boss. You know, I'd accept that. Then he talked to me about how to treat people, and that it was important that you treated everyone equally, that you were considerate and respectful. And combined with what I mentioned earlier about the environment in the school that I was in, where there was a real focus on what do you do for your community, and that's just blossomed here at Northwestern. So I went out, I didn't have it before I came to Northwestern, but I showed up and got in the business world and happened to join a firm that was very focused on corporate responsibility, and it just played to the strength. And so when I got into leadership roles, you had the resources, the people to do important things, and I walked away from that experience saying, well, you just gotta do this, you have to do it. And so one of the reasons that I'm involved in Haiti and a number of other things is because of that. And more businesses are really focused on that. It's a regular part. It's not some of a throwaway where you have a little department that gives away a little money. It's how do we passionately serve the people in the world? And as we'll talk probably a little later, the global aspect is very important.
Yes.
So
beautiful. Thank you. So, Terry, you're up next. You've had a great career as a legal scholar dealing to a large extent on feminist issues. You're the president of the iconic National Organization of Women now. You know, yeah. So this is my sixth year here at Northwestern. One of the things that really surprised me is how many women who, you know, were here over the generations have done that kind of stuff. You know, you're not the first at Now, you're not the first as a feminist scholar and all that. And I just sort of wanted to ask you about that. And one thing Mimi and I are still trying to come to grips with at reunions and homecoming is that, you know, I spent a lot of years at a great little college, Williams College. The first four-year graduating class with women was 1975. You know, just the same as at Yale and at Harvard and Dartmouth and Amherst and Princeton and all those schools. These were great schools that were around for hundreds of years, but never open to women. The first four-year graduating class at Northwestern with women was 1874, 101 years before all those great liberal arts colleges and Ivies decided to open up their doors to the other half of the population. So you think that has something to, can you reflect a little bit? I'm sure you've thought about that before, about what is it about being open to women a century before the Ivies and the leadership positions that so many of our women have taken?
I think it had a big influence on me, although I was not involved in the women's movement in my college years or for many years thereafter. When I first got to Northwestern in the fall of 1970, and the Vietnam War is still going on, right? And I'm this idealistic kid from a small, you know, boarding school in Connecticut, right?
Yeah.
And, I'm going to go to an anti-war demonstration. So we go down there and it's 1, 2, 3, 4, we don't want your effing war. It was just such fun. But then at the end of it, and I was all pumped up, I thought it was great, and this very tall, thin guy with very long hair starts yelling at me. He turns out he was with the Socialist Workers' Party, and he was berating me for being bourgeois. And I said, you know, I'm from suburban Connecticut, and I'm at Northwestern University. Of course I'm bourgeois. What? You know? But it didn't, so I didn't do the activist part, but absolutely I absorbed an enormous amount of sort of a history of empowering women. I mean, two of my, I think, big influences at Northwestern were Lila Heston from the School of Speech. She taught interpretation. She taught how to read a text for what isn't said, what is implied, what's not there. It's the speaker, you have a speaker, and then you have a voice. And they're two, they're very, so she really forced us to go deep into that kind of, you know, reading some kind of a text. Mm. And then over in the French department, there was Sylvie Romanowski, who was teaching 20th century French lit in French. You know, we just struggled, and she wouldn't speak English in the classroom. But at the time, her big interest was actually postmodern French philosophy, which was all about puns. She had more fun in the classroom talking about, you know, the idea of, you know, executing, when you execute a contract, you execute a plan, you know, with a little guillotine. You get the guillotine executed, and she but really pushing, and these were dynamic women who just honestly took their leadership roles somewhat for granted, I think. And that was enormously helpful for me. I mean, I have in my career experienced things like suddenly I'm not on the same pay scale that my classmates from law school were on, and I complained. And the senior partner says, oh, Terry, it's just money. And I said to him, oh, really? Okay, I'll take your salary, and you can have mine. I did. I said that to the senior partner. I'm not sure. I was pretty young at the time.
Yeah.
But yeah, so I think it absolutely had an impact.
That's a great story. Excellent, yeah. So, Kip, you pointed out you came here as a varsity athlete, and I know it was a very important part of your Northwestern years. Patricia Tejas Irvin, who's sitting over there, is Vice President for Student Affairs. She and I spent about an hour and a half yesterday with a group from the NFL, Roger Goodell and a group, and I was really struck at the end. We were talking about protocols for investigating sexual assaults and the like, and it was a very interesting discussion. But at the end, the head of football operations was a Wisconsin alum who played many years in the NFL, and as we were walking out, remember Patricia, he said, I have three kids at a very good private school outside of Baltimore, and You know, so I know that school well, and there are actually four varsity athletes in a variety of different sports from this school. It's Gilman, and they're all different. I mean, not different from one another, but different from other varsity athletes. That Northwestern recruits certain kinds of athletes, holds them to certain kinds of expectations, and I was really surprised because we were a little bantering about the Wisconsin game and everything, and he said, "Oh, I'm Wisconsin." I said, "Yeah, what happened 2 weeks ago?" So we didn't get off to a good start, but nonetheless, he ended up by saying, "I have the utmost respect for the varsity athletes, the 492 varsity athletes." So can you talk a little bit about it? Because we're very much in the news with the unionization and with a lot of things going on. Can you reflect a little bit about, you know, what your take is on varsity athletics then and now at Northwestern?
Sure. I couldn't be more excited now. Just a little plug, you know, Morty's the best president, you know, in all of the NCAA. He always, when he asks me a question about the basketball team, he assumes I actually have time to follow who the recruits are and everything. But if you ever have a question about Northwestern athletics, there's just nobody who knows more about it than Morty and is more supportive. But it's funny, again, being on this panel or being at Northwestern, I remember as an athlete being more intimidated, and you know, you come to such a great academic environment, so many driven people. I did not know what I wanted to be, and I think there historically has been a little bit of a divide between the athletes and the other students. And I guess over the past 20, 30 years, what I have seen, and Morty, I think you and Dr. Phillips do a great job of this, but I think it's fun to have a school where, you know, we do play football at a very high level. We do play basketball, hopefully, in the future at a very high level. I mean, the women's lacrosse team, for example, is there anything better than talking about the success they've had? And so the whole idea of athletics and academics and, you know, being a school that searches for excellence in everything we do, it's very fun to be a varsity athlete. I think the Northwesterns, the Stanfords, the Dukes of the world, I certainly feel good. And as my kids grow up and want to play sports, I think there's a whole growing part of the population that would say, that's where I want my kids to go to school if they play sports. Mm-hmm. And I don't want to necessarily talk about any of the other schools, but I certainly don't think other athletes are required to go to class, excel at class. You know, the graduation rates are, you know, really dismal at some of our competition. So I'm very proud of it, and I think at least my sense is, as I interact with other alums, I was in New York a couple weeks ago, and all everybody wanted to talk about was the Penn State victory and the Wisconsin victory. So I think that's a cool part of our school, and I hope, Morty, you continue to do everything you're doing. And I think the world's coming to us. I think over the next 10 to 20 years, most of the NCAA programs are going to want to be like us.
Boy, I hope so. Thank you. So we had an article in the Alumni magazine last year called, I think it was Wildcats in the White House or Wildcats on the Hill or in D.C. and everything. And I'll tell you, I was amazed by the number. We're talking about Cody Keenan, who's back this weekend, class of 02, is the president's chief speechwriter, our friend Dan, you know, and there's so many of you. So as somebody who's continues to be with the foundation but worked in the White House, so what is that about? I don't know of other colleges or universities that have that incredible representation. I go to D.C. a lot. I'm going to be back, I think, at the White House on Monday. And it's just like whenever I walk into West Wing, it's like a reunion. I mean, they all come out and they all say hi to me and everything. There's so much purple there. And when the president came here 2 weeks ago, one of the first things he said backstage was, "Oh, you know, I feel like I'm home and everybody I know." And as you said, Cody had the hat on Air Force One. So what's the draw? I mean, I know why, but what is something that happens here? And once you get a couple of you, you just take the rest, or what's going on there? Yeah. And how can I sign up for it? No.
Yeah.
So tell me about that.
Yeah, that's a great question, because I certainly noticed, and I was surprised by this, when I first moved to Washington in 2005. how many Northwestern alumni were there. So I thought, oh, Chicago, I'm leaving Chicago, and in DC, I'm gonna know fewer Northwestern people, when in fact, it actually seemed like there were more. And I think there's a number of reasons for that. One is that certainly Northwestern has such a tremendous range of student groups that are really focused on the public interest, and how really can we as students start to make a difference? So don't wait until you're graduated or you're settled in your careers. How can we start making all the difference today, even if we don't have the money or the clout, you know, still this sense that we can do something. So I think you find that in a lot of different organizations here. I think another aspect is certainly the alumni community in DC is very strong. And I think you find this in a few other cities as well, but I say DC in particular, of the Chicago, you know, New York, I've lived in Connecticut. I think the DC alumni community, particularly among young alumni, is so strong and supportive. And particularly in a place like DC, where jobs may not necessarily be publicly posted, but it's really a question of who you know. I think there's a tremendously active and supportive alumni community. And I know when I was in the then Senator Obama's office, and even when I was in the White House, I would receive calls from, you know, the Northwestern Alumni Association or from the career office saying, hey, can you meet with, you know, these students who are coming? And I think that, you know, to get a call like that, you know, I think is incredibly important. I don't think other schools do that as much. And then finally, I think also one great thing about being a political science major here is that when I was in school, we had a number of professors who were, or adjunct professors, who work professionally but then teach a course at Northwestern. And I think having exposure to adjunct faculty who have really tremendous, you know, whatever they're doing, but really tremendous ways of making a difference, I found to be also influential in how I thought about it, and I think certainly a number of my classmates as well.
Thank you. That's great. You know, Ana had mentioned sort of the Northwestern Wildcat kind of entertainment mafia, if you will, and everything. But it's funny, I never really realized until that article came out that we have a mafia there in D.C. that helps and mentors each other as well. I'm gonna have one more question, then I'm gonna open it up, and it's just a very quick thing. These are obviously alums back, but I'm asked to speak to current students literally every day. And they always ask me sort of, what should I do? You know, how can I avoid making mistakes? So I just wanna hear from each of you, and I will recount this, you know, as soon as I get back into the dorms and fraternities and sororities and stuff, when they ask me and I do these things, and I'll say, so here are five exemplars of Northwestern, you know, what we can produce, incredibly successful in your own careers. You know, what's the one bit of advice each of you would give to a current student? Ana? A current student right now in anything.
Just
a student who's here.
Yeah.
You know, it could be play a club sport, join the Greek system, volunteer, yeah, or take a class in art, any one thing.
It's funny to be considered sort of a, whatever, celebrity or have that name sometimes attached to me, because I actually really think of everyone I know from Northwestern, an incredibly glamorous group of people. We're worker bees. We're hard workers. And I don't see anybody kind of copping out on their responsibilities. And along with being a worker bee, you know, in my industry and all entertainment, it's just, I was saying this morning, you can't really just, I got to Saturday Night Live, you can't sit around and rest on your laurels. You have to find the next opportunity. It's this, just like mini businesses all the time. And so that means a few things. That means saying yes to all kinds of opportunities. Things come your way, especially through this incredible community that we have. And I said yes a lot. I said yes and yes and yes and yes. I still do it whenever I'm kind of trying to create a phoenix moment for myself. Throw the pee on the ceiling and see if it sticks. And I don't think being snobby or being above this kind of art or that kind of art is productive in any way, because you just never know where, first of all, the relationships that you have now are going to lead, and second of all, where the opportunity is going to end up. So that was a major influence of the school, and something that I would continue to advise to young people, just to look for the positive in things and to say yes. It's cheesy, but it's effective. Oh,
that's great advice. Thank you. We can clap, yeah.
Let me pick up on that and take just a little bit different shot at it. One of the things I've learned, I'm privileged to be a trustee at the university, and so we get familiar with the dozens and dozens of programs, and it's a proliferation that's way beyond anything that we had when I was on campus in the early 60s. It is very easy to say yes a lot and then find out that you're overwhelmed. And in fact, we had a panel recently among the trustees about, are the students beginning to burn out? Are they already in their adult careers and they're missing out on the opportunities here because they're overwhelmed with the activities? If I had a granddaughter that's about to try to get into Northwestern, my advice to her would be, you've got to take some time to get settled and then look at what the opportunities are. Finding out is not the easiest thing in the world, but you've got a lot of technology that'll help you do that. Once you've found out, then be careful about the ones that you select. And as you begin to build toward a career, you can be a little more focused that way. But then put something in that's fun. I mean, last night at the Lake Effect seminar, they showed pictures of the new Northwestern boathouse down on the south end of the campus, and we've got 35 sailboats down there. And if you belong to the sailing club, you can go out and sail on Lake Michigan. I thought, wow, I sure wish that had been available. But something fun would be one issue. Being careful that you don't take on too much is another. And being able to carve out some time for thought and maybe some independent reading. This is an incredibly rich environment. You'll have it once in your lifetime, and I think the work ethic is there among our students, and I just want to be sure that we use the time wisely. So,
great advice, good.
That's better. I think failing is a really good thing. You know, you fail because you fail, and then you try something else, and then you do something that succeeds, and then you figure out what to do when you fail. I don't think that it's really necessarily about having that backup plan. It's about actually experiencing the need to find a backup plan. Worker bees is exactly a good description, and I keep hearing discipline. The Northwestern really instills a sense of discipline and work, and that nobody expects to skate when they're here, but it's not like you succeed at Northwestern because you're all that. It's you succeed at Northwestern because you've put the work in, because you're smart enough to come and be able to do the work, but you have to do the work. And if it's not something that's working for you, you can certainly find something that will work. But I think that's, you know, of course, now I will admit to being sort of a workaholic. But honestly, you know, my experience at Northwestern was, believe it or not, balanced. I waited tables for 20 hours a week, and it was, what I loved about it was completely mindless. It was very physical. You're just running the whole time. You're not having to think deep thoughts that Professor Romanowski would really respect. So it was a nice balance, and you can get that. But especially for those of us who went to college not really knowing what we wanted to end up doing, try something that you can safely fail at. That's a good thing to try.
Yeah. That's great. Thank you.
Pick up on a couple of those themes. I think the kids today are so driven and so stressed out. It's so hard to get into college today. I would just combine the first three comments and probably just say, relax. When I think back, and this is not necessarily why to do it, but why Northwestern was so fun and get to be on a panel here, but I think about a Steve Shimbaum who was a friend who was in a theater department, or bumping into Teddy Greenstein, who now writes for the Tribune, or Mike from Mike and Mike, Greeny, all these people that you meet that go on to success in so many different areas. And, you know, to give Morty another compliment, I think one of the things that Northwestern has always been a little bit unique, there are a lot of different schools in this concept of one Northwestern that Morty's done a terrific job of. But I wish, when I look back, I had made myself go to more of those theater shows, or I had maybe taken some of those classes that weren't necessarily on the path I wanted. And Northwestern really gives you a chance to do that. And it's so fun now to be in, you know, LA and call an old friend and hear all the inside stories about the mafia out there, or to bump into a friend and hear about the mafia at the White House. And it's all because of Northwestern. And we can all talk about that. You know, sometimes people think it's not very sophisticated to go to a football game. But boy, it's fun to talk about the how we beat Penn State, and then that leads to what's going on at the White House, and then that leads to Mean Girls really is one of the best movies ever. And that's unique about Northwestern. And I don't know exactly how you tell kids when they're 18 or 19. You know, I think they have to sort of learn that on their own. But it sure is fun 20 years later.
Yeah. So. Great. So picking up on that, I think, you know, certainly agree, I think, with everything that's been said. And in particular, I'd be remiss if I didn't say that I met my husband at Northwestern. So certainly taking the time to meet people, relax. He was an art history major. He works in museums and the arts now. Probably somebody I'd never meet in the professional world. So, you know, certainly meet as many interesting people as possible. And you never know where that may lead. But in addition, I'd say one other thing that I'd really counsel students today to do is to really be humble. So I think absolutely in kind of the rat race of today, and it's so hard to get into college now. I don't know if I'd get into Northwestern today. I don't know if my husband would. That always take a step back and remember how lucky you are to have the opportunities that you have. And then when you're working with and interacting with other people, to kind of keep in mind that there's a lot of luck involved too. So don't, you know, kind of, you know, wear on your sleeve that I went to Northwestern, I'm really smart, I really deserve this. Treat people with respect and, you know, go into any situation realizing that you can always have something to learn. Nothing is beneath you to do. And, you know, just be a pleasant person. I think sometimes people just forget that when they're in that kind of race of we've got to one-up everybody else. So that would be another piece of advice to give.
That's great. Well, it's all great advice that I'm going to share, including that last one, don't forget to date. I'm going to put that one, I'll remember that one too. Okay. So as promised, we have about 20 minutes. So we're going to pass around, just raise your hand and just do us a favor and introduce yourself, say what class you are. And we already have a couple hands up. So there's one over there. We're going to go around with the mic and you can address it to anyone on the panel or everyone on the panel. Here it goes. Yeah, please stand up and introduce yourself.
Steve Rung, Medill 74. I was not a feminist in 1970 when I arrived on campus for 2 weeks. Two women were sitting on the edge of my bed having a political relationship. I asked them why. And they said, "You haven't read this book." And they slammed it down, "Our Bodies, Ourselves." Later we had the Height Report, reports on Soviet women. Each generation seems to have something that is informative. What would you recommend that a member of the public read today that would have the same impact?
Terry, great question.
I got to go back to what I'm actually reading right now. Of course, what I'm reading right now is not there, although I just picked up, because I've been rearranging my house, and I came across a book that was written in the 1980s by a historian named Gerda Lerner. I don't know if anybody has, it's called The Creation of Patriarchy. It is absolutely fascinating and brilliant, and I read it when it first came out, and I just sort of sat down and started rereading it, and it's much better the second time. I mean, it's really fascinating. I think that's a key book to read. Anything in women's history, anything from, you know, many of the women's history books. The other thing I really think would be fascinating, what I've been doing, what I'm reading right now, are actually some memoirs. I just finished Elizabeth Warren's memoir and Hillary Clinton's second memoir, and I'm just about to start Kirsten Gillibrand's. And what's fascinating to me is the personal story of how those women kind of came
to be pushing the policies that they push, to have the vision that they have. They all came really from quite different places. And I think you need to do that. But I would strongly recommend the 1980s Creation of Patriarchy. It's a brilliant book.
While we're waiting for the second question, there's one over here. You just mentioned Hillary Clinton. You, of course, played her very famously on SNL for years. You work for her now. Any reflections? It was funny when I asked you before if she runs, are you going to be in the campaign? You said, I'm too old, I'm 31, which I'm still, Jim and I were like a little horrified by that answer. Any reflections about Hillary Clinton from anyone on the panel, particularly the three women, about, you know, the role she's playing and has been playing for decades as just an extraordinarily impressive person? Yeah.
So I'll quickly start and say, I mean, there are times where I really do have to pinch myself and say, even though I've had such tremendous professional opportunities the past decade plus, to be working for someone like her who's made such an impact over decades is really is humbling, frankly, to be around. And the work that I'm doing with her now, and I've never worked for her before, been working at the Clinton Foundation for about 16 months now, but she is someone who is so focused on making a difference no matter what kind of sphere it's in. And so we're, you know, nonprofit foundation. We build and run our programs, and we're doing really innovative, interesting work that may not be reaching, you know, millions of people, but we're reaching, you know, hundreds of thousands of people with really concrete, meaningful action. And it's so great, I have to say, that to be around someone who still has that passion and energy of saying, you know, no matter, you know, what phase of her career she's in, how can I use this opportunity to make a difference in people's lives is pretty fantastic.
Mm-hmm. Terry, you said,
yeah,
you were affected by the book.
Absolutely, yeah. I think really two things. I've always been interested in what happened between the first and second waves of the feminist movement in the United States, right? You got the right to vote in 1920, and then it goes into a trough to the point where, right after World War II is over, women are being fired unceremoniously, without cause, without recourse. And that was the great migration of women, yes, out of the workplace and into the home, as if they did it deliberately. No, in fact, the evidence shows that they were very unwillingly were fired from their jobs so that the boys could come in back from the war and get jobs. So I'm asking myself, you know, why how could that happen? And I personally think it's because there was not an organized women's movement, that the suffragist organizations felt that they had served their purpose and they disbanded. I think it's only because of an organized women's movement that the movement in the late 20th century and in this century overcame the stalling out of the Equal Rights Amendment, which was defeated in 1982, and yet there were organizations. Anyway, the thing that ties us back to Hillary Clinton, she's not the first woman Secretary of State, but she is the first Secretary of State, and so far the only one, who has made it a point to lift up organized the organized women's movement in every single country she goes to. And by the way, there is an organized women's movement in every single country on the planet today. Most of us don't know about it because there's not a lot of spotlight shone on it. So one of the things that she did that has been so visionary, actually, is she gets it. That in order for women to move ahead, they do have to have organizations. And she as Secretary of State, she went through and insisted on meeting not with the elite women, but with the organized women, which is sometimes very different. Anyway,
that's great.
I think it's huge.
So Ana, I'm not going to let you off the hook here because, you know, your portrayal of Hillary Clinton was amazingly funny, but it also humanized her in a curious way. And Any thoughts about that?
I would actually say that, so people always talk about my role as a woman in comedy, which is often just an accidental moment of era, but part of it, you know, started because I started doing comedy at NU. It was a very balanced sort of back to the Meow Show had an equal number of men and women in it, whereas the Second City did not, which is interesting. And I don't even know if they still do, strangely enough, in their balance, in their ensemble. which just sends an unconscious message that your voice as a comedian matters. And that was at a time that not that many women were known for comedy, yes. Particularly. When I got Saturday Night Live in 1996, I had female comics come up to me on the street in LA and say, I'm so sorry, you're gonna get eaten alive there. It was just not assumed it was gonna be a good experience as a woman. What's sort of interesting is that the role of the show has always been to parody and reflect back the culture at large. So when I started parodying Hillary Clinton, it was as a victimized wife. It was because of the antics of her husband. But what really became interesting, and there was nothing to do. Like, nobody wanted to laugh at it. It wasn't particularly fun to watch this sort of hurt wife. And it wasn't until she actually ran for Senate that there was something to put your teeth into as far as a parody and get a point of view and things to call out and mimic or whatever. So really, the job of the comedian on that show has just been kind of elevated by the unconscious power, basically, that women have ascended to culturally throughout, everywhere. And I was actually even lecturing the young men today at the Meow Show to make sure that when they become showrunners, that they make sure to cast the funniest women around and not just the prettiest, because it's an ongoing kind of challenge that, you know, that is in the process of changing and evolving, I think.
Yeah. Thank you. It's great. Yes, please introduce yourself. Stand up.
Sorry. I'm Robert Wesley from the class of 84, College of Arts and Sciences, and a former colleague of Terry O'Neill. And so I guess I would be remiss if I didn't give a question for Terry. I was impressed by how many second acts you've had in your career. And I guess my question is, of all the jobs that you've had, which was the most personally rewarding and fun? Was it being a law professor like me, or is it being the president of Now?
Can I just say, when I first met Robert, I was on the hiring committee at Tulane Law School. And here he is in there, and of course, I was running late, as always, and I hadn't read his resume. And so someone said, oh, you know, you graduated from Northwestern undergrad, and I perked up, and I said, oh, you graduated from Northwestern, so did I. What year did you graduate? And he goes, well, 1980, la, 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 and I'm like, oh. That was kind of after my time. Never mind, move on. Let's just talk about you. So, yes, it's so wonderful to see you there in the audience, Robert. I have to say both. You know, I loved teaching law, much better than I thought I was going to when I first got the job. I left teaching law partly because my actual training is in corporate law and corporate finance. That's how you make money. That's what I did as a practitioner. And so that was the law that I taught, and it became very clear after tenure that they were never going to let me out of teaching corporate law. And it wasn't the direction I wanted to go. I taught feminist legal theory, and then I taught international women's rights. So that was, I really wanted to do that, but I knew I wasn't going to get out of teaching business enterprises and partnership law and that sort of forever. So I did leave, and I jumped into doing political work. But I to this day, I miss the classroom. I really do, and I miss being able to think things through. Although I have to say, I have 5 unpublished papers on a feminist analysis of corporate law. Nobody wants to publish that. No? But it was my version of rebelling against the economic analysis of corporate law. And someday it will get published if I ever can extricate myself from Now.
Question over there and then over in front.
Hi there. Jamie, School of Communication, class of 2018. So, as young as you can get. So, one thing I learned very, like, immediately when I set foot on campus is the importance of communicating with others. So, I just, I'm sure the panel has had many of these experiences. Can you recall one of your favorite moments, or maybe it was with a group or through a course, where you kind of opened your eyes to the importance of communicating your ideas effectively with other people?
Uh, Jim, you look like you're ready for this. Yeah.
I'll hark back in answering to your question to one of the professors that I had, who was referred to earlier today, Larry Lavengood in the business school. And I think what really struck me was that he was so articulate and so able to use the language that it just lifted the whole level of the class up a notch. And that, and I would just sit there and admire. Sometime I had to slow down because I was so taken by his language that I forget what he was saying. And I just get all hung up on the, wow, that's a neat phrase. But he did articulate extremely well, and that was important. It's one of those things you carry away. You see it not because it's in a textbook, but you see it mirrored by someone who you respect, and then you carry it on into what you do in life, and it's something that I try to do all the time with the speech making I do and all, is to say, all right, am I being articulate? Am I careful to understand what the audience is? I mentioned that I've been down in Haiti. Well, 2 weeks ago I was teaching in Haiti a group of young Haitians how to start businesses. And you gotta use a translator. Well, that's a whole different world. But I learned I had to be very simple in the way I was describing things so that it could be translated, so that it could be conveyed to the actual audience. So it's one of those things you pick up. But certainly Professor Lavengood was, you know, my shining light on that.
That's great. Thank you.
David Huter, College of Arts and Sciences, 1964. And also emeritus faculty of the medical school at Northwestern. And my topic that I wanted to raise has to do with the latter. I was on the admissions committee for the honors program in medicine, which is, for those of you who don't know, is an accelerated six-year program where someone coming out of high school can go to be an undergraduate at Northwestern and then finish up with their MD degree after 6 years. Northwestern is one of the first and one of the very best in the country. And as you might expect, I was routinely seeing the very cream of the crop of high school graduates come through applying for this program. And I oftentimes would be looking at someone and I would be saying, are you sure you want to go through in 6 years? You can go to Northwestern's undergraduate program and experience all the things that we've been hearing about, all the opportunities that maybe you don't even know you want to experience. Do you really want to go through in 6 years and shortcut yourself of that experience? Because I'm telling you, with your background, you could get into any medical school in the country you want to. And I found myself in a bit of a quandary. I would sometimes be counseling these people to not go into the program. I think I was unsuccessful in the vast majority of them. It's probably good for the program. But I wanted to get the thoughts of the other people on the panel of these accelerated programs. I'm sure medicine is not the only one. But.
Any thoughts?
Okay, I'm just gonna, without meaning to talk about, I think that's a really great question. I think a lot of the push for going into accelerated programs has to do with the cost of higher education. And millennials are deeply, deeply aware of those costs. You know, my 23-year-old daughter is caught up in a very different world from what we experienced graduating in 1974, for sure. What college education has gone up 1,000-fold, between 600 and 1,000 times since I think I was in college. It's striking. And I think taking longer makes a lot of sense. Allows you to do the kind of balance, Jim, that you talk about, and it allows you to have those experiences and maybe go into a sort of a blind alley and back up and go somewhere else. But I think that the outside pressure there is huge.
The only thing I would add, Morty, I don't know if you would comment on this, but I think the world is changing, and I think because of cost, and I think there are a lot of kids that know what they want to do, and everybody is in a hurry to go, but I think when I think of universities, I don't think of a lot of flexibility. And one of the things I worry about just over time is I do think these are big questions, and I think over time we have to be willing to change or provide different programs like this. So I don't know how that's going to work out, because on the other hand, you know, forcing people to get a liberal arts education, forcing the balance and a number of other things, we I think we've got to stand our ground there, but the world is changing pretty fast, and I think cost is a big factor. I don't know what you think, Morty, about that.
Well, this is my field, as you know, Kip. So the only thing I would say is that there are about 1,800 private, not-for-profit colleges and universities in this country. 35 of us are need-blind. Northwestern is one of them. We meet full need. We have a sizable percentage of the freshman class who actually pay nothing, including room and board. So sometimes people ask me, as president of Northwestern, what was the last thing you'd give up if there was a much worse version, God forbid, of what happened to the world economy in 08? And I said that it's that. It's, you know, the gift we've heard about, we've seen what happens if Northwestern gets it right. And that should be available to the best, most talented people, regardless of family circumstance. And I sure wish we had more than just a couple of dozen of us left in this country. Every year, several peer institutions with very large endowments per student, in some cases larger than ours, decide to become need-aware. And need-aware means you have much lower standards for people who can afford to pay the sticker price, you know, all in $60,000 a year after tax. And then if you're really talented, but you're really needy, at need-aware schools, quite often they don't have a place for you. So the last thing, the best thing, I think, about Northwestern is that need-blind. Let me ask for help. We have five more minutes, and you know, everybody sort of needs, in marketing, right, a slogan. You need a one-liner, and you know, Kellogg School of Management is top business practices in a team atmosphere, right? McCormick School of Engineering and Applied Science is whole brain engineering, where you do the creative with the analytical. Beaton School of Music is the best of a conservatory in the setting of a liberal arts college. You know, that's the sort of thing. So what would you say is the one-liner for Northwestern? And just to get you thinking, Mimi knows, for me it's always the most incredible students in the world without the same level of entitlement at other universities. And that's literally, you know, I can tell you, I've been to a lot of places, I've had tenure, a lot of great places, all over the world I've taught, you know, Oxford, you know, Ivy, everywhere. And, you know, the most amazing thing, and we saw it in the panel, and you talked about humility and modesty, you know, that's really what, that's Midwest, but that's specifically Northwestern. So I talk about that all the time. You know, they say, how are you different than these other great peer institutions? I said, we have every bit the same talent, but without the same sense of entitlement. So that's my one-liner. What would you give the one-liner for Northwestern University? Ana?
Read between the lines.
Can you explain that a little bit more? I'm working. I'm grappling with that. Read between the lines.
No, actually, I really was struck by the conversation about what I think. I'm speaking as a graduate of this now School of Communication, School of Speech. We were asked to think, I think, as a thinking person's actor, and a thinking person's acting program, which is to say it was expansive performance studies, the way you talk about language, the way language asks itself to be understood both literally and in its pauses and in its unspoken messages. And I think I learned a tremendous amount about performance and writing just from being exposed to that alternative point of view. And also in art history, Hollis Gleason's class, which is probably the only real place I learned history, which is social history of art and why things were happening, why people were painting and what they were painting when. We were just asked to think that way. So I think it's an unconventional context for teaching theater. At least it was when I was here. And it's not just stage combat and funny accents. It's really thinking about why plays were written, when they were written, what constitutes theater, whether poetry is theater, whether nonfiction pieces are theater. So maybe my slogan is just just for the School of Speech.
I don't think so. I mean, now that I get it, I'm sorry.
Yeah, well, it's also, you know,
in the what we do
show.
Is we don't teach people to read the lines. We teach them to read between the lines.
It's also
I think
a
we
little
do
bit
that
of a middle
in
finger
econ math
metaphor.
As well. Yes.
If you must know.
Okay.
But, you know, I'm a late night comedian, so I'm comfortable with bad language.
We're going to steal that, and guess what? We're not going to credit you, but thank
okay.
you.
Okay, thanks.
I
that's
that.
Fine. You don't have. You can steal
You're
it.
Used to that. That's okay. Jim?
I'd say we show students the world and educate them to be successful in it. That's a one.
I like that.
Well,
So globalization in all of our programs from Feinberg
opening,
School of Medicine through School of Music and...
That's the world we're going to
we
be
train
in,
for success.
And we're preparing them for that global experience.
Yeah. You know, one of your trusty colleagues loves to say leadership for life, which is another version, but I kind of like your slant on it. That's great. Yeah, Terry?
You know, I think some of what we talked about gives me the thought of, you know, leading by listening or leadership
yes.
through listening. Right.
That's a great one too.
In the
yeah.
sort of not sense of entitlement, but real. Yeah. I mean, Northwestern people really are very high achieving.
Mm. So. And we listen before we speak, which is makes it a little unusual. Except for Anna, she seems to be anyway. Yeah.
So I thought of two. The first one sounds like the Marines or something, so I went away from it, but. Be challenged, have fun, Midwestern values.
Mm-hmm.
And the best I could come up with, reach for the stars with your feet on the ground.
Ooh, I like that too. Yeah. And I like the fun part too. I mean, everybody mentioned it's important to have fun and enjoy your lives rather than just suffer through it and check off another box on your way to whatever you're achieving. On your way to, I always use as an example, on your way to Yale Law. So.
But I do think
she, of course, went to Yale. It's not in a pejorative way. It's just that sometimes people are so focused. And literally, the day they show up, you know, they were focused in high school to get into a great school because they're thinking of Harvard Medicine or Yale Law, as you went to, or Stanford PhD or Goldman or McKinsey, whatever it is. But, you know, that's a terrible way to lead a life.
I was just going to give Morty credit again. I see a big transition at the school, and I don't know how others feel, but when I came, it always felt like there were a number of people who, well, I didn't get into Harvard or Yale, and now I'm here. And now I see a big difference. Right. And this, you know, fraternities and sororities are okay. You know, watching the Big Ten Network, watching our lacrosse team beat the heck out of somebody. That's part of the fun that I think if we could figure out how to do that and the Ivy League type education, yes. I think there's something there.
Excellent. Final word, no pressure.
Yeah, fine. And yeah, no way I'm going to do, I think, as great of a job as everybody did. Especially I don't have a line, but rather a stream of thoughts, which is that something I'm reminded by as I'm sitting here is how many great individual programs there are. I mean, almost every one of the programs here is world class, and that's pretty unique for such a university that has so many schools and so many programs. So something about how Northwestern is kind of greater than its individual
yes.
parts, because I think there is
yeah.
something to the point Anna made as well about how having those world class programs can influence the others in a really kind of productive and interesting and challenging way. So that would be the way I'd really
Beautiful.
Think about Northwestern.
You are all wonderful. Let's hear it for the panel.